Greetings once again. Romans 8 continues. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. So there's more to that, really, than meets the eye. Because I can translate it for you. Oh, it seems like the way it's written is, yeah, I'd like, oh, one more, thank you. Up it. All night, the Lord is ministering to me and put me in a state of peace. It's the most amazing thing, but let me shed my understanding on this, which was given me tonight, when 1 a.m., 1:30, 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock, I mean, going all night. Shall be able to, shall be able those in Christ are unable to connect with the world because neither death nor life nor angels nor principalities or powers or things present or things to come or height or depth or any other creature shall be able to unseparate us from the world. It works both ways. Included in this scripture are both things. Separation from the world and connection to the Almighty Yah. Both things. In other words, there's no force on earth that can connect one to humanity if one has been separated out by the Lord for himself. Usually these are called Nazarites, and they're not the typical body of believers you would see in church. Now you see, this is where it gets difficult. You are not the same as them, physically, even from birth. They are programmed to kill the lame horse. They shoot horses, don't they? So that none of you exist. But they failed. Now there's a cloud of witnesses that are here to witness the Lord's movement. And in a very mature fashion, speak it. What is seen and what happens. And I'm in touch with a lot of you, you know, that are just like me in a sense. You are not meant to grow up and become men and women in society. Everything that happened to me, the things I struggled with, you know, separated me further and further from the grip of humanity, which of course is going off a cliff and which always devolves to genocide and chaos. Not something to be proud of, by the way. Being a hero in Earth's terms is fleeting at best because the world is fleeting. There is no way that some of you could have ever been a contender in this realm of humans. And I have to speak of them as humans, as them being human. What is it? Well, there's really...
God, that's huge.
Okay, so, no, I don't know what I've done here.
It's
Well, you got to get it out of here. I'm stuck with the word. I'm sorry.
Okay, go for it.
Okay. Okay, no, we didn't lose it. We're continuing in that word. We simply hit the pause button. Oh, there is a pause button here. Okay. Well, I'm, you know, converted over to the, you know, I hope this is okay. This is recording directly onto the iPad, something that has been a good tool. And I'm just looking for the Bible tools that I can put on it now, but I don't think I can record and then be on another page doing another app at the same time. So I have my Bible open here. Back to the point. There is no way that you could have measured yourself against the popular culture or the norm because you are genetically, physically different than the bulk. It's a mistake to think. And of course, the spiritual and the physical are all intertwined. It's a mistake because from the youngest age, I have been exactly who I am today. From the youngest age, nothing influenced me to become different than I am. There was no trauma. There was no event. There was no abuse. There was no word. There was no teacher, parent, or other kind of influence that changed me or helped me develop another way than what I already was. I am the same today as I was at 3. Exactly the same spirit, exactly the same thoughts, exactly the same mind, exactly the same being, no different. No different. If you hear anything there, my dogs are eating they're eating chicken strips. I'm no different than I was. I'm trying to give you a word. I'm going to give it to you. And this is a huge rhema. All right, this is crucial, because if you get this, you'll have peace. I am the exact same spirit as I was then. I am no different now. Had I not been protected, I'd be dead. And for no, not for some sinister reason. It's almost unconscious. It's just, you know, one species sees another species or something different, and they kill it. You know, it's just impersonal. I don't take it personally. Don't have the same sense of identity, gender, thoughts. How many of you feel conflicted? There's only so far I can go with this. What I'm really hoping to do is to share the peace that I have with you. That I'm at peace with all that has happened. And all that is, all that I consider to be afflictions, thorns in the side, or the witches throwing things on me. Nothing has been thrown on me that the Lord did not allow to be thrown on me for the purpose of keeping me even further separate. It was very successful, the Lord using those witches to throw things on me that helped me to run the race and win. Thank you, Lord. Understand? Do you? You don't get this, you're going to suffer. You get this, you'll stop suffering. I'm going to call this talk the end of suffering, the beginning of peace. There is no way that I would have been anything other than what I am today. And I am exactly the person the Lord wanted me to be at this time. I've arrived exactly at the destination He wanted me to arrive in, and exactly with the thoughts and the makeup and the understandings and the physicality, everything that He wanted, I am. And there's different purposes to each. Like we complain about, you know, the carnal things. Oh, well, I'd like to be skinny and have a lot of things, have a lot of money, have whatever it is. That's all vanity. I'm here to tell you that you know, they in the world can do that. They can go to their gyms and they can do their thing and they can buy their this and that. I can buy the same things, but it's not the same when I buy it or when I go, because I'm not like them. They're not like me. They're not like you. They're not like us. We're not like them. You know, we've gone around and around on this. Here's where Satan tortured me. For many, many years, I beat myself up because I wasn't like them and tried to fit in some way. And I would determine every morning that, darn it, I'm going to connect with someone. I'm going to, you know, I probably wanted to be conformed to the world more than anybody on earth. Like Pinocchio, I wanted to be a real human. I did. I know this sounds crazy in a way, but it's literally the truth, and the truth oftentimes is unsettling. So I spent my life wanting to be like them and excel in those things that they did, whether it be sports or academics or, you know, jobs or, you know, whatever it is. And some people said, well, your parents screwed you up. They kept you out of it. And it's not true. You know, this has been revealed to me. That's not true. They didn't do anything wrong. In a way, they were burdened with me. Because I wasn't, you know, if I was somebody else, there would have been, you know, school and high school and graduation and college and fraternity and law school and, you know, whatever. You know, it would have been the typical thing. You know, that was the ethos of our family, was that kind of trajectory. And that's what it would have been. There's nothing that they did that would have stopped me from any of that, from emancipating onto what you might consider, you know, manhood and career and all those things. I used to blame my you know, my mother or my uncle or my, you know, situation or circumstances or myself. You know, I had to blame somebody. You know, that's typically a typical reaction, but it's false. I am the same person today as I was in high school. All the things that are given to all the people were given to me. But they couldn't take, because I'm not them, they're not me, and that difference makes it impossible for those things to take hold. So they separated me into the mental hospital, because obviously there's a problem, and that actually makes sense. I don't think that's an abnormal thing to do. Don't start barking now, because I'm trying to say this here. Molly, don't bark, just sit there. I think we've you know, probably has a light gone off yet. So I used to blame, like, being, okay, here we've got a, Trish,
yeah.
Cat at the door, please. Is there any chance that I can do a word here? I'll take another coffee. Cat at the door.
Yeah.
Please wrangle the, you know, the animals. I'm sorry, folks. This is a very casual word. I'm sitting here at, you know, we're kind of in the middle of, anyway, I'm saying this also to people that perceive themselves to be my enemies, because you're not my enemy. You're an enemy with something you don't understand. I am as legit as you are, as emancipated as you are, as much of a being in my right of being a being created by God as you are. You do not emancipate me. God emancipates me. And not man. Similar to John the Baptist, let's say. But, you know, he was also different in that way, and that's why he was told His parents were told by the angel Gabriel that you're going to have to get him out of here because he'd be killed if he remained in Jerusalem, his father being the high priest, and the expectation that the son would follow in the father's footsteps or at least not become a shame to the parents. By being odd, or as they would call it, lame. So we just, we don't want them to suffer, so we shoot them. Now I'm telling you this so that you will rejoice. If you're honest with yourselves, you'll admit that you're the same person today as you were then. The circumstances that occurred in a lot of ways were shaped by the kind of person that you are or were. And you're still standing here, no different, because they would have to kill you to make you different, then you'd be dead. And when I say they, I'm talking about civilization, the bulk of humanity, meaning the bulk of the populations upon the earth. There are certain expectations for sons and daughters to grow up and take on certain roles as sons and daughters and do certain things. And then there's the deep, dark secret of what it takes to make those things happen. And they take to it because they are genetically, physically, in every way made. They may consider it a trauma, you know, their sort of, you know, initiation into the world or whatever. And the parents will justify it by saying, well, that's what you know, needs to happen so that they can be viable. Otherwise, you know, that they would just be adrift, separate, wandering. No, we wouldn't want that. Indeed. Indeed, it's less understood in the West than it is in the East. In the East, the people like that are actually honored. They're separated from the group, and they're put in the wilderness as sannyasins and, you know, the Buddhists and various people that are, you know, like the Buddha. You know, he was obviously separate. He couldn't handle his father's kingdom. He could not conform to his father's kingdom. So he left to find a solution to humanity. Well, that's what I'm doing. I'm doing the same thing he did. Finding the solution and coming up with it through the wisdom that God gives me. Through my experience, I've gained wisdom into all these things. And last night, there was a breakthrough revelation about shame and guilt. It goes back to the old story of the ugly duckling. The tragedy of the ugly duckling is the ugly duckling wasn't a duckling at all, but genetically a different species. And yet kept comparing himself to the a regular duck, and then beating himself up for it, which was a false premise to begin with, and the same is true of you. The same is true of afflictions. Let's just take weight, because everyone wants to be in shape. And weight is a marvelous separator, because it'll make people recluse themselves and not do things they would have done. The Lord is the author of weight. If someone threw it on you, like Frankie and I used to laugh about fat whammies. Then there's a game out there the witches play, which is, you know, the Jezzies play, which is basically they're usually the skinniest person, and but everyone around them is fat. You know, it's a weird. It's like almost like they're putting their fat on other people through magical means. it's weird. You know, it's weird. I've noticed it. I don't dwell on it because it's really pathetic. But I. You know, it's almost, you know, pathetic and embarrassing that we would even play games like that, but I don't think anything's really different from the sandbox. That's what I'm trying to tell you. I'm the same person. Back in the second grade, I remember, you know, I was shunned by the entire class, and then another day I was embraced by the entire class as like the hero, and then I was shunned again. Same person. You never know when that shunning comes. You know, you never, the people who embrace you, the next minute, you know, they're putting a dagger in your heart saying, you know, you're the problem, right? I mean, it goes back, but it's never the same. You're not like them. You're never going to be one of them. And I knew that in the second grade. I couldn't be one of them. They would, you know, love me and then hate me, but it was always different from the way they were with each other. Second grade. No, identical. Sadly, those who attempt to conform, meaning, but they're a different species in a sense, get killed because, not because they weren't obedient or trying to get, but because that difference gets them killed, and you have to go near them to get killed, and so the attempted conformity would then get you killed if you're one of us, but if you're one of them, you would be loved. But if you're not one of them, you wouldn't be loved. You would be then set up for a sacrifice, because that's just, you know, the devil's world at this point. So through extraordinary means, the Lord has caused you and I to survive and be here as mature adults with wisdom and knowledge to share, to put light of truth, of Christ, of truth, which is truth, on the entire situation. This means to the parents out there trying to conform their children so they can be viable in the workplace or whatever reason you have for their corruption, to be just like mom or dad. And boy, what a lovely life mom and dad had, huh? You want to be just like them, yes? Never the twain shall meet. You know, you know. I have a friend that is a, you know, he's in affiliated with all, you know, manner of social clubs and this and that. And those are places I can't go and I don't go. And we don't discuss that. I mean, I talk about the Lord and the Word of God and things like that. But I mean, there's this sort of line there. And that wasn't put there by me. That's there by the Lord's creation. And the people that are called to serve him and are called according to his purpose are those strange people that they've just soon put in a mental hospital for being crazy, or kill them. But they're never going to mesh. It has nothing to do with character development. I'm the same at 2 as I am today. So there's no development that happened. I'm just the being that was created and put upon the earth. I'm the same being today as I was then. There's been no change due to circumstances. None whatsoever. Circumstances all ordained by God for the purpose of bringing me, as you see, as you hear today, this man who you hear today was brought here by him to be exactly as I am this moment. Indeed, it couldn't be any other way. It's just really extraordinary to me because our people don't mean them any harm. You know, we're here with the only purpose we can actually serve here is to be servants of the Most High God and to bring the Word of God forth. I'm not talking about 501c3 conformed to the world type pastors who wouldn't know the truth if it bit them in the you know what. They can't bring the truth because they are not of the truth. They shouldn't be pastors, but the devil appoints them to be pastors because, and I know where this is going. Oh, that sounds like a real paranoid complex. We're all the same, Zeph. No, there's our people have been getting killed all the day long for thousands of years, and it's done in secret. It's done over there. It never makes it into the news what the line is. So God proposed a way to bring his people up despite humanity and hide them in the midst of humanity and confound the wise with the foolishness of his own, which is foolishness to the world, but wisdom in absolute, implacable terms. You run the race to win. Now, Paul was in the world and then a convert. And that's, you know, he's not the same kind of person, but he did go through the same persecution when God separated him out. Then after that, they came against him. Because you see, it's not him personally. It's that he represents something they don't understand and feel threatened by. And, you know, he was meant to be the man he became, to be a man of the world, to be an Esau type, and then to be eventually a Jacob type, to be a man of the Spirit. In the Spirit, those of us who are of the Spirit, who were sent here for a purpose, and oh, by the way, the purpose need not be verbal. God has put his people around, some just to stand there and not say a word about anything. They're just put there. And that alone does the damage to the delusion, to the lie that is told about civilization, humanity, and the dirty little conformity thing that no one wants to talk about, but everyone surrenders to because, well, they don't want to be a bum on the sidewalk or whatever reason they try to assimilate. You know, you do, in Rome, you do as the Romans do. That's completely understandable. But those that are different in the way that I'm describing would never be accepted, no matter how many hoops they jumped in, whatever the antics are, whatever the means of initiation, whatever the way in is, it would never work. It would never really, truly. You say, well, Paul, he was in. He became a man of God. Well, the church is like him because, you know, he represents them. They're of the world, the 501c3 church, and they hope one day to be separate unto God and to be able to stand up against the force of humanity, which frightens them. It shouldn't be frightening. If you have God on your side, the humanity is nothing. And the force of humanity is irrelevant. And all their sorcerers and witchcraft and all their stuff can do nothing. Nothing. Won't touch a hair on your head unless he allows it. But that would be for his purpose. And it doesn't mean that he allows his people to live either. Oftentimes they'll take one of his out. Herod tried to take everybody out just to get Jesus. And then what happens? Herod goes down. What happens when they try to take you out? Have you ever looked back and seen the body count? They get taken out. I've seen people's careers ruined. Public humiliation. You know, scorn and, you know, rejected by the group. I've seen this over and over again by people that did not heed the word or didn't heed a prophetic word given by those of us in this walk, whatever you want to call it, are prophetic. If we give a word and it's mocked, there will be action against that person. Legally, we have the right to speak the oracles of God. It's not an arrogant boast. This is just, you know, I know it sounds like that, so that's why I have to say I realize how this may sound to someone in the world. I can see the labels now. Paranoid, antisocial, blah, 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 needs help. Let's get him a psychiatrist. You know what I mean? And that would be for anyone that speaks the way I'm speaking. I'm fully aware how it sounds, but in no way diminishes the reality of the situation that this is literally true. As bizarre as it is to the shrinks who work for the society at large to assimilate it all. And now they're deciding to bring the gay ethos in, which is, gosh, show me something new. That's usually the immorality. And when I say the gay thing, I mean, I'm not talking about, you know, relationship or trying to have gay be like marriage. I mean, this whole song and dance and circus really is pathetic, completely, utterly, incredibly stupid. They're the stupidest people on earth promoting all this stuff. It's unbelievable calling someone a sex act. I'm gay. Oh, you like anal sex. You are anal sex because you're gay. Is that absurd? It's done for political purposes and it becomes another conformity thing. So the children will be taught you have to be gay or, you know, then you won't be assimilating, and those who aren't, that's just based on purely physical, conforming to, you know, when in Rome. But the deeper thing is that the actual conformity to the world has to be in the spirit, or else they get killed. That's another deep, dark, dirty secret. They can jump through the hoop and do everything that mom and dad tells them to do and get into the club and to find out they have some accident or something happens, or just, you know, the plane goes down, or, you know, the thing sinks, or, you know, there's a hunting accident. You know, something like that ends up going on, because that mission's been compromised and God has to bring them home. They got confused. They thought they were, you know, a human. Now, I don't like to talk like that because I know what that means. You say, well, you have blood and you have a heartbeat and it's pretty typical. We can measure your vitals. You're all too human. But in consciousness and in wiring, not really. Not in comparison to the bulk. I'm sure that there's many that I'm addressing. Many. More than they would like you to think there is. They don't want you to think there's many. They're always trying to guess how many there are. You know? Many. Listen, Mr. Robert Plant. Many! You know, it's just like there's a lot of sperm that goes to the egg, right? To make sure that egg gets fertilized. Well, there's many of us put here. And not all survive to get the job done. Someone's going to get it done, right? That makes sense. The farmer would plant more than one seed. So the truth will come out. I say that to Robert Plant because he had a song that was, you know, speaking to his own, you know, his own church. The Led Zeppelin guy, you know, who went on and had a little lesbian folk music career later on, but and won Grammys as a lesbian folk singer. No, I just mock him because he was a great artist. I've absolutely have tremendous respect for his talent, and especially during the old Zeppelin days. But the songs were about, you know, the opposite of what I'm talking about. So it was like evangelism for the satanic. And at one point, he was trying to figure out how many people were on he called it the open road, along with him. And he said, you know, many, many men cannot see the open road. You know, of course, I'm sure he's recanted that by now. He's gotten older. And then he said, many is a word that only keeps you guessing about a thing you really ought to know. And then kind of, you know, nod, nod, wink, wink, you know, laugh at the idiots who can't see the open road. And it's like, no, we see your open road. The Bible, nothing new here. The Bible calls that the big wide path to destruction. That's the open road. There are things you can do, but it has to be spirit. It has to be real. That will bring you to the open road. But then he said, many, many men can't see the open road because it's veiled to them. It's an occultic reality that you enter into through the, you know, it's the break on through the other side you enter into through the physical. But, and then he says, many is a word that only leaves you guessing about a thing. In other words, he's guessing, you know, they're guessing about how many of us there are and how many of them there are. We don't know. He knows who he is and they are, and he knows how many are not. So he can see how many, but you can't, because you can't see the open road. And to him, I would say, from the very beginning, from a very early age, from the age of 2 or 3, I became aware of this situation. And I knew that that path was evil and led to humanity to destruction. Somehow I knew that in my being. I was not developed yet intellectually. I couldn't yet speak, but I knew it. And the reason I knew it is because they were trying to put me into rituals that involved all this stuff we're talking about. And this, you'd say, well, that's a pedophilia. But no, it was about something else. It wasn't about sex or any other thing that they do. know, because their sex and death go together. But I mean, anything like, it wasn't about that at 2 and 3 years old. But it was about conformity and to see who was, because these kids were put on the open road at that age. And they knew they were there to serve humanity at that age. And when I say serve humanity, I don't mean, you know, altruistic works or whatever. They knew about the ranking system at that age. They knew to service the adults, the ones above them, and they would get things and go up the ladder at that age. And so by the time they got through their college years and fraternities and things, they were running the world. The heads of all the Illuminati organizations or whatever. That's the open road that Mr. Plant was referring to. He was just saying, gosh, it's so easy. You know? Wouldn't be a rock star today if it wasn't for that. And we're talking about nothing less than bridging the spirit and the physical and the cashing in of the soul through trauma-based ritual abuse to bust to the other side for the purpose of now seeing the open road or the world as it is, taking one's place and then working up easily through the system because it's no big deal. It's sussed. I remember my cousin used to mock me when we were kids. Oh, man, she's a real piece of work. Used to mock me because she was, you know, having such a good time and I was troubled. And, you know, I had a friend that was a very prominent artist today. And we grew up on the same street. And I just recently got in contact with him. He was always a great guy. And he wrote me a letter. You know, we've been very honest in our emails to each other. And I haven't gotten together with him yet, but I'm sure that will happen at some point. But he was saying how he remembered me as a teenager. And he was like 4 years older than me. And he was like the leader. You know, he was the guy that he drove the carpool to school and all that. And like I say, a great guy. You know, really excellent human being. And he was very nice to me. You know, at that age. But he remembered me and he said, you know, I just remembered you were troubled. You were so troubled. And I wrote it back. I said, brother, I'm still troubled. And I've been troubled throughout my life. You know, that's a good word for it. Troubled, you know. Not negative, but just troubles, you know. Not enjoying life, not enjoying my youth, not, you know, just troubled, just trying to live and not really being able to. Obviously not accepting of the truth that I'm speaking today, because had I understood that, I would have, well, I probably wouldn't even be here, but I mean, the thing is it would have, I wouldn't have been troubled, would I have? I would have understood there's a war on. And, you know, when you're behind the lines and a refugee in a war, you're going to be troubled. So it would all make sense. But it didn't. There was a confusion. So I was troubled and confused. And I wasn't like the other kids, you know, who went to school and they went on to college and they did this. And, they're pretty typical. Most, you know, some committed suicide. Some got killed, you know, that were the kinds I was talking about that were like, guys, well, let's call them lambs. And they were taken to the slaughter, you know, and at a young age. And somehow through the events in my life, I was spared that. But that's what most likely the odds were most in favor of my not surviving adolescence because I was different and, you know, therefore troubled. And you know what I mean? It's just you know, they shoot horses, don't they? You know, it's just one of those things. I was troubled. That's what he said. He said I was troubled. You know, that was the you know, not that I was evil or that I was, you know, a bad guy or that I was just rebelling or, you know, wasn't that. He recognized there was trouble there, whatever behavior there was with drugs or you know, it was all coming out of that. It was all coming out of that thing of self-medication because you're troubled. It wasn't like, hey, rock and roll. You know, it wasn't, you know, party on, Led Zeppelin. Yeah, rock and roll, the Beatles. Yay, LSD, pot, whatever. You know, and party on, and then we go to college, you know. No, troubled, can't function in school, can't function in college, very depressed, unable to function, dysfunctional. But there was nothing wrong with me. That's the point. Nothing wrong at all. The point was not the right planet, the conducive to not being troubled. You know, an opposite situation, you know, coming into a situation that was not adaptable. Not through pride, not through will, not through a decision that I'm just going to be rebellious against whatever. Just existing as that, just from the get-go in my spirit, there's nothing I could do. Genetically, a species difference, something like that. And as I said, there was also a gender confusion along with that. You know, there was like an androgynous kind of thing going on. There were male and female kind of competing for dominance within me. And it's something that never actually did get resolved. It's what I've come to understand is normal with our people. No, I'm not going to become transgender, start, you know, wearing a dress and makeup tomorrow. No. I'm in the grandfather character category now. You know, but that was, I found later when I met others that there was a similar thing, both in men and women. Really hard to explain because they don't have this issue. And I'm not talking about transgender people who say, well, there was a confusion, I've decided to become more like a woman, I was a man. No. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about this conflict where you're male and female. Our people are like that. That's a genetic species difference. Oh, I can prove it. You're going to get it, you know, one way or the other. So that one could not blend in because of the same reason that if you take an ant from another colony somewhere, it goes to another colony, they just kill it. You know what I mean? It just can't be. And we're not talking about the guy that decides, okay, I'm gay, but really I'm a woman, so I'm gonna, you know, or the she-male thing where I'm gonna be, you know, a woman, but really have a penis and, you know, go out and be a prostitute. That's completely off the topic. Has nothing to do with what I'm talking about. What I'm talking about is wedded to the spiritual as much as wedded to the physical. It's intertwined. And so the point is, well, you're getting a lot today. The point is, there's nothing wrong with you. The painful events that happen because of being different, being, you know, the GLBT community is not going to help you because, you see, you're the opposite of what they want. The typically clandestine hetero community that is really kind of underneath has a perversion going on where anything goes, and then on top it's, you know, the surface, what you see isn't what you get. You're unacceptable to that too because you can't, you know, you're not, you see what I mean? There's no place you can go. It's not a psychological thing because the same exact thought processes and patterns were there in the very beginning to the earliest memories. So nothing happened. You know, nature and nurture, the idea that events shape your life, that's hogwash. The same being will be the same being. You know, they may be have tics and, you know, flashbacks and PTSD, all kinds of things like that as impediments, but they're still the same being that attracted those kinds of things, that attracted those traumas. And God says, why use the traumas? So you can stay separate and you can still stand. You're traumatized, but there you are, traumatized. I've been traumatized most of my life from just this thing I'm talking about, not from as much from events or from being tortured or anything like that. You know, in other words, torture me in order to get me to be like them. That was like another thing. And what I was left with, the artifacts of that are shame and guilt, resentment and anger, and those things. But that's not me. You see, I'm able to let those things go. Because the shame and guilt is based on a false assumption. Shame and guilt is based on the idea that you'd be like them, which you're not. So therefore, you can't use that as a paradigm of judgment. So therefore, you can't have shame over what you did or didn't do or became or didn't become or whatever happened, because the comparison wouldn't be to them. You should compare yourself with someone like you. And in that case, there would be no shame or guilt. You couldn't have done any better, going back to the theme of my last talk. You couldn't have done any better. Understand? You couldn't have been any different. You would not have reacted any differently than the way you did. So, you know, I kind of put the rest, this idea that, you know, other people prevented me from becoming, from having a career and being an emancipated human being on earth. That is untrue. I thought that for a long time, and people made those observations, friends, but that wasn't it. You know, putting the blame on, say, my mother, or she has no fault and had no influence in that way whatsoever. She was just trying to hammer me into being like her, and it couldn't happen. But the only God can prevent you from, you know, you go to the slot that you're made, how you are, and that's where you end up. And no parent, no nothing can stop God's will for you and the path that you're on. In other words, everything that happened to me was God's will all the way down the line to today. And everything that has been done, everything I've gone through, has been a complete, marvelous success, amazing success, and completely successful. And the equivalent would be winning the decathlon in the Olympics or something. It was amazing. Winning the sprints and the hurdles and the relays and the shot put, the discus throw, whatever. It's winning the Super Bowl. It's on that level in a different realm. And with God, those of us who are like this are completely emancipated, even at an early age. Into adulthood. But adulthood for me, for you, I'm assuming you're listening, is not the same as adulthood for them. It's like you're looking at, an orangutan and say, a chimpanzee. I mean, that's probably a bad example. You're looking at a dog and a cat. I don't know, you know, something that never the twain shall meet. You know, the orangutan is not going to be a chimpanzee or a gorilla, and vice versa. They may have similarities, they may eat the same things, they may have heartbeats and all that, but they're different species. And there's just nothing that orangutan can do to conform to the way of the gorilla or the way of the chimp or chimpanzee. There's nothing that can be done about that. To have guilt and shame on the part of the orangutan for not being more like the gorilla would be absurd. And thus, you see my point. And no, this is not a repeat of what I used to say for the past 10 years. This is a new groundbreaking thing, because it means today is the end of guilt and shame for all of you. If you take the word to heart, you too will be free of guilt and shame. You will be free of self-judgment and criticalness. You'll be free of all these things, because it's all based on comparing, you know, an orangutan to a gorilla. There's no way the orangutan will ever be like the gorilla, or even comprehend what the gorilla wants, or how they, you know, or a dog to a human. The dog is never going to be able to be
as lovely as dogs are and they can go wherever you go, they can't be human in the end. Now, can they? I mean, you can look at, well, they like to call us dogs, so, you know, you can go look at it that way. But I call them dogs. I call them heathen. I call them the great unwashed. Because they don't know the Father. They say they do. I see them every day. But it's okay. It's okay. They know him in the way they know him. You know, I'm not saying they're going to go to hell, by the way. I'm not saying the 501c3 church is really going to hell. I mean, you know, the people there, they're not all bad. It's not all one thing. I'm not absolutely not saying that. I'm saying there's a different way. There's a variety of situations going on here. There is not a one connection serves all to humanity. And if we all would just connect like that, then the war would be over and we'd all have peace and love in Atlantis. No. No, my friend. No, humanity is fallen. Is fallen. Was fallen. Humanity is and was fallen. Needs to be rescued. Because look what they do to each other. Look how they kill each other. There needs to be something done about it. So God is working all these things. Creates all these beings. But the biggest lie that was ever perpetrated on humanity is that we're all the same. That is a Luciferian statement designed to destroy as many souls as possible, period. There is no other way to look at it. I dare anyone to argue with me. Anyone. I will tear you up one side and down another. But you know what? I won't even take the time if you email me because you would just be there as a time waster. When I see time wasters, you know what happens? They get filtered out forever. I will never talk to them again because I only have a limited amount of time here on Earth, and I want to make sure that we get, that our people are set free. You've already been set free in the sense you know Jesus. You know Yahweh. Yahuwah. Yahuwah. Yahweh. Jah love. Whatever. I'm not talking about reggae. You all know. You know, you have an idea, a feeling that, you know, you're connected with God, but you're frustrated because you still have guilt and shame. You still have physical issues bothering you. You still have your poverty, and you prayed to God to eliminate it, and it's still there. And darn it, you know, why does it have to be so hard? But see, you missed the key ingredient here. You're still there. You're still there. You shouldn't be there in the first place. And you're still there. That, my friend, is a miracle. Why are you beating up yourself for something God so magnificently wrought? Why are you judging something God so amazingly beat the world, you know, at the cross and then with you? Put them to shame, yet they export the shame to you when they walk free? Something wrong with that. Something wrong with your thinking, isn't there? You have it backwards, my friend. You're thinking that, you know, you're not as good as them. Are you kidding me? You are an absolute miracle. They are typical. And they go down. You know, we're not here to go, my daddy's better than your daddy. That's not it. We're here because they go down and we want to rescue them from going down, even if they spit in our faces. So I came into complete peace this morning with this revelation, which is something never before, you know, hinted at. You know, we got around, we've kind of gone around all the edges of it and kind of, you know, but this is really front and center, shot to the heart, okay? We've been around this whole thing and we never really nailed it. So this is something new. That this, at long last, the issue is put to rest. You don't, and I know, there's the people, let's go to Paul. He converted and then he got all kinds of torture and whatnot. But he'd already had great success, you understand? He did not have shame and guilt. He was proud of the gospel and he was really happy to have come through. And he stood there and he knew the cost. And he wasn't traumatized by when things would happen in that way. that you're traumatized. You know, like,
why are they doing that? I don't understand.
From the first I remember, this has been happening. And so it's not comparable to Paul. He's a different case than you. You know, you would be more akin to, say, John the Baptist than Paul, you know, if you will, who got killed, admittedly, at the whim of some Jezzy Salome, who just wanted to have some fun and have the head on a platter. But, of course, look who she's connected to, you know. Look at that despot Herod. You know, that's the world. Salome is the world, right? Salome is the Jezebel that's hunting the John the Baptist out there. That's Jezebel hunting Elijah all over again, right? And Jesus called John the Baptist Elijah. So we get right back to the real battle would be, you know, and I guess in human terms would be, and Elijah is just like, is one of us. And he had to live in a cave. He was head of the prophets, that's true. And you saw what happened when those kids mocked him. God hates the mocking. He, you know, it's the devil hates it, but God, we are not to hate it. We are to accept it. But then he hates it, and then he takes them out. The kids that mocked him got eaten by a bear. Now, that's how God sees it. You don't mock these people. You can mock each other, go ahead, but not these ones. If you do, there'll be a consequence. Your life will be ruined. I guarantee it. Guarantee it based on 58 years of watching them ruined, watching them hit the wall. And they're so prideful, they go, yeah, it's just talk. I'm going to persecute you, see? It's like, well, go ahead. But I pray nothing bad happens to you, because you should see the last guy. And I don't even look. I don't look. I don't direct anything. I don't pray against them. I don't bind and loose that tortured crap. I don't bother with it. Because I don't need, that's carnal. I just go through. I receive great blessings from the Lord and amazing blessings that could only come from Him. And every blessing I have, every opportunity I have, every successful thing that I've done in, commerce and whatnot, all these things were set up by Him. I mean, every single thing was just, you know, it's just unbelievable that you're guided by His hand and He leads you into success. You go, well, you can't be successful. You need to be one of us and go through all our hoops. Oh, yeah? Well, let me give you an example. How did, how does Wall Street do? They're all vetted. They're all on the open road. How's that working out for them? Do they make mistakes? So they're not really being divinely guided. I'm talking about no mistakes really being made. I'm talking about prosperity. You know, and you know, you may not be, prospering right now. You may be struggling. And the Lord just says, quit struggling. I'll give you money. I'll give you provision. If you're struggling, then something's wrong. Over the last 10 years, I really didn't think about... Did we think about money very much? Did we worry about money the last 10 years? I just don't... You know what? I've always had a problem with that. I never really worried about it. There's always been opportunities and you know, maybe it's just the gift of my birth, or I don't know exactly, but there's, you know, even when I was like, I remember being a musician where I was making a living by playing drums, you know, that means, you know, buying my food, paying my rent, nobody's, you know, there no sugar daddy, no nothing, no extra, no rich girlfriend, nothing like that. And I never worried about it, you know. I came into some money and I blew it on something. I didn't worry about it after that, and then I had more. And so I just never, I was taught, I guess, or something in my makeup where I've never really focused on it. You know, and Because every time I, you know, now there were times I focused. One time when the 90s I got into day trading, I tried to, you know, I don't know what happened. It was during that Bill Clinton era where all the dot-coms were going and everything. It was very exciting. I kind of entered into that casino and I really got into it and I lost my shirt. I worried about it. So I quit worrying about it and then I was restored again. But when I put my focus on it, boom, Lord won't let me do that. He won't let me focus on money. Won't. And it's just never been a, you know, it's technically, if you listen to the gold bugs out there and, you know, the shows we've done and we've had Mike Horsey and others, by this time we should, not that we won't be toast. I mean, you know, that we're in terrible straits. But I can't worry about it because what's that going to do if I worry about it? In other words, it's always been like my mind's been on other things and then other things were added to it. You know, the ability to survive was added to it. They said, well, you shouldn't survive because you're not really part of the group where you could prosper by business connections and things like that. And I'm like, no, I don't understand. And I really don't. I've never seen business connections get people rich. I mean, I guess, you know, they do. Let me rephrase that, because I have seen business connections get people rich. It's not that. I've never seen people clinging on to social groups, churches, clubs, social clubs, and so forth, get rich by it. There's always a distribution of rich people and, you know, moderate to poor in all those groups. The ratio stays about the same. That's what I really meant to say. I didn't see the group change and everyone become prosperous because they joined a certain group. Howard Hughes proved, of course, that you could be completely separate and off the wall and in a recluse and continue to make gads of money. So it's even be considered to be a freak by people. And that didn't stop them. So people's opinions are not what blocks you from provision. It's your obsessing on provision that blocks you from provision. It's just a built-in thing. God will not, you know, provide if you insist on worrying about it yourself. If you're going to worry about it, he'll say, okay, fine, go ahead and worry about it. But, you know, without my help, you're not going to get anywhere. And then, you know, the next thing you know, they're on welfare and food stamps and things because they put it all on their shoulders. They can't let it go. And then, oh my God, the guilt and shame. You know, if I wasn't a lamb, you know, I wouldn't be in this situation. Oh, that's the worst thing you can do, and I'm here to remedy that. No, you're a great success. Shame and guilt over what you did or didn't do, or success or lack of success that you had or didn't have, is irrelevant because you're not like them, and you weren't like them at 2 years old. So you can't compare yourself to something. And now I'm not making an excuse for people called bums. No, it's real dicey territory to speak of because the other side will say, you know, this is antisocial and psychological trauma, hasn't dealt with it, thinks he's something other than humanity, that's omnipotent thinking for the purpose of being able to survive psychologically, having been, you know, through a trauma and then not being able to assimilate back into society and therefore coming up with this idea of another species. And you could just see what the shrinks would do all the way to the bank with this. I assure you I'm of sound mind in the sense that I know your arguments. I'm not pushing for a genetic study or insisting on some kind of alien intervention or God creating some other species. I'm saying that there's a differentiation and it could be argued, not proven through scientific method, as a way of teaching about the situation on the earth, because psychiatrist friends will not look at the word conformity and all that. They don't see that. They don't. This whole thing about, you know, the world system, Babylon, all that, they think that's completely insane. They won't look at that and say, oh yes, that's right. And you have to be vetted in your youth so that you can go on and be viable in the workplace. They won't accept that. They'll say you can just, you know, they won't accept. They'll tell you to assimilate, and then they won't tell you what it would take for you to assimilate, or even assess if you could assimilate based on your spiritual character. I'm here to tell you there are different spirits inhabiting different bodies, and never the twain shall meet. Some are gorillas and some are orangutans. Men are from Mars, women from Venus, whatever. Just like there's a difference between male and female. And, you know, doesn't every afflicted class feel, you know, like they're either special or downtrodden, one or the other? And isn't that all you're talking about, being disaffected? And if you were, you know, and I'm saying, well, at 2 years old, then I was disaffected. At 3 years old, I understood the difference. At 5 years old, there was a couple attempts on my life. Completely unconscious, just someone just manifested and tried to drown me in the kid's pool. He didn't know why he did it, by the way. He just, a feeling came over him to hold my head down underwater. I couldn't breathe. You know, he just felt like doing it. He couldn't explain why. Oh, it must be something with his mother. No! Or his father. No! Something came over him, a spirit, telling him to drown me at that moment and took him over as a kid. To prevent this very talk from going on today. That's how I see reality, like in those kinds of terms. So, let's just review this. The fact that you are existing means you're extremely successful. You can drop the guilt and shame because you could never be like them anyway, and it's an unfair comparison because it's apples and oranges. There was no way that you were ever going to be anything different, or things that would happen would be different than what happened. Nothing you could have done could prevent even your sin patterns, your reactions, your drugs, your drinking, your lying, whatever it is that you've done to survive. You're still who you are, and you're not who they are. Even though they and you have done similar sins. We've all done sins. And we have that in common. But no matter what sins you do, and you could even become a hitman for the mafia and go kill people, but if you're you, they won't trust you and they'll kill you too. You'll never be like one of them. And them being those vetted by the world system and those who have made their homes in the flesh and exist to perpetuate their families and bloodlines as a way of eternal life through the blood, because they don't believe really in anything after this. And you know, there are some that do believe, Luciferians, who believe they will become, go through an apotheosis, or they will become divine beings and then sail up into but that's not true. Those divine beings are demons, and that's all they can actually become. They could become a demonic being, and then they wouldn't actually be them anymore. But that's okay. You can't explain things to them. They're so ignorant, and they're so lost. They're so prideful, they don't want to hear it. They don't want to hear the truth. I guarantee George Washington is not a divine being right now. Don't know where he is, but he's not the guy that they put in the Baphomet pose in the rotunda or wherever he is. He's not that guy. That's their delusion. All their architecture in Washington, D.C. also, and this is a repeat, it is also showing how deluded they are, showing how backwards they are, showing how they're just barely one iota above barbarism, showing that there is a huge world underneath they're not telling anyone, yet they're nodding and winking people in all the time from various schools and universities to take their place and make money and be vetted. You scratch my back, I scratch yours. Yeah, until there's nothing left to go around, then all of a sudden it's I'll stab you in the back or you stab me, and they end up killing each other. Well, you know, that's not something I'm interested in. I saw how pathetic they were at 3 and 4 and 5 and 6 and every year of my life. I was reminded how evil, or let me put it another way, how ignorant my parents were, for example, how ignorant the church was, how ignorant the school was, how ignorant the various groups and social clubs were as a body, as a group. Not talking about individually. I'm saying when they were in the group, they became ignorant, superstitious. They would eliminate anything that was in their way for making money. And then, of course, if you were around, that would have been you. They would keep their houses clean because Satan might bless them, but of course there's no such thing as Satan. We don't talk about such things. I mean, that was basically it. You know, that was basically my life. You know, there was a surface reality, and then there was this underneath, you know, huge civilization of demonic bondage. Bondage to spirits, bondage to familiar spirits, bondage to the group spirit, bondage to these disincarnate beings who would then rule over the city of Los Angeles and any other city. And that still exists today. And I'm not saying that that won't change till God changes it. So why are you here? You're here, basically, as a precursor to the end of their delusion, of their ignorance, of their folly. A great example of folly would be something like NASA. You know, on the one hand, secretly they have advanced technology that they keep it out of the public eye, and they fly around this tin can called the space shuttle, and you go, oh, isn't that marvelous how advanced that is? And of course, that's not just not advanced, it's a joke compared to what they've got on tap hidden. Not just NASA, but you know, that whole military-industrial complex. Compared to what they've got hidden, what they're not telling you about, the space shuttle is a joke. Richard Branson, Virgin Atlantic, he's building a, his name Richard Branson? He's building a spaceport here. And he's, you know, for a couple hundred grand, you will be able to fly into space, you know, go up into space and come back. And, you know, eventually he hopes the price will get down to where just, you know, they'll be able to fly over the pole and get you from, you know, here up into space and then down into Europe or somewhere across the world in 15 minutes, you know. And then those prices will be eventually like airplane prices today. And that's the idea. And now I'm all for it. I'm all for capitalism, and I'm all for the private exploitation of space. I'm 100% for it. And I'm not anti-social, because I'm not anti-society. I'm pro-survival of me. You know, unless the Lord tells me to lay my life down, but I'm pro-survival. I'm pro this idea that I have a right to exist just like you do. Just like anyone else. For all my life, I was told, you don't have a right. You don't have any right to exist. You know, if you do exist, you better do penance for the rest of your life. For what? For being what? For being you, different, not the same. I'm not going to do that. I'm proud of what God does. He's got you all confounded. Totally confused. You can't figure it out. Because God's pulling all the levers, including the devil, all the witches, and everybody, and he's getting everything he wants. So I'm not worried about the end of the world. Because the end of the world for me came at 3. I've already had the apocalypse. Nothing could be... Oh, if they dropped a nuke, I'd go, yay, charge it, let's jump in. Into the light, it's the rapture. You know, if it's this world or another kind of corporate structure or another kind of thing, what do we care? Who cares? If it all goes down, who cares? So many Christians I see hunkering down with their food and their ammo and their shortwave radio. It's just. You know, at what point are you going to drop your pride and just be a child of God? At what point are you going to serve the Lord?
Well, this is all serving the Lord.
No, it's not. It's serving your own fear. And how many of these people have come in the name of God and they've gotten all excited about the stories, spinning narratives of the end, trying to come up with times and dates, you know, influencing all of you to listen in. Like you're getting, have you ever gotten anywhere by listening to someone spouting, the rapture's next week, it's all going off the cliff, better get ready? You are ready if you're a believer. There's nothing else for you. What do you want? It's almost like they want you to do something more. What would it be? Start spinning the same narrative. Start saying the same things so that, you know, then we can get the word out and save humanity. Well, I will put this testimony today and this wisdom today and this rhema today and this prophecy today and this spirit talk today, I will put this up against any story like that. I will put it up against any story like that because I don't think Christians should be in bondage, do you? What if they were to get out of bondage? Wouldn't that be something? Most of you have no idea what I'm talking about, but some of you do. And that's just it. I'm here to minister to the few, to a very small select group. As far as the bulk of humanity, they think they have their religions. They think they're saved. So there's no talking to them about anything. That's not my mission, thank God. But, maybe it's your mission. And I don't want to belittle it. But I don't envy you, my friend. I don't envy you. If you're preaching to the churches or to the choir or to the 501c3 or anything like that, and yet you know what's going on. I mean, you really do know. You're not just... Most people I talk to that are in ministry don't have a clue what's going on. And it's truly amazing. I sit back and I'm like, you're that ignorant. Jesus has made no difference. You say you've got the Holy Spirit, but you don't have the truth. Something wrong with that picture. You haven't been shown the way it is on earth, have you? So yet you pastor this congregation. And you're proud of yourself for pastoring it, and you've talked to people in their home, but really all you're doing is keeping everyone on the same boat with you, which is called delusion. And somehow, through your worship music and all that, you all think that it's all cool. So therefore, you don't have to think anymore because you already got Jesus. It's all cool now. My sin, i.e. connection to the unconnectable, is covered. Because it's just sin, so it's cool. Oh, really? Well, then why am I here? If you could just get rid of me, then you wouldn't have anything to worry about. Just shoot the messenger. I am a messenger. I am a messenger. I repeat, completely truthful, this, and I am a messenger. And we all know what they want to do to messengers. But, you know, you take one of them out, another one pops up. It's just one of those things. You can't get rid of the truth. Even you churches can't get rid of the truth. You religious establishment, you're there to get rid of the truth. How shame on you. You should be there with the truth. But I know you feel like if you did the truth, you wouldn't have any money to eat and you'd lose your congregation. Hallelujah! Don't you trust the Lord for your provision? No. You'll never leave your prison cell, will you? And yet you're a pastor of a congregation, but you're in prison. When are you going to tell them that you're the one in bondage and that you're just preaching is just keeping them on the hook, spinning another narrative every week, keeping them on the page? Well, how are you going to answer to Yahweh when he says, didn't you set those people free? Wasn't Christ there? Wasn't the Holy Spirit there? We fed the poor. We visited the sick and the imprisoned. You know, we preached the word as best we could from the perspective of from the perspective of connectedness, which then corrupted your ability to do so. That is, preach the truth. When I read the Bible and you read the Bible, it's completely different meanings. And I realize that I'm not going to beat myself up because I'm not like you. Because God made me exactly the way I am. I came out this way. And for you to be prejudiced against me or to persecute me would be the same thing as, you know, persecuting anyone in society that you don't like. You know, I understand why you don't like the truth, because your church would crumble if you spoke the truth. And everyone that's tried to speak the truth got, the hook came out to grab them off the pulpit. And that's the problem with every church I've ever visited. Every single one is like that. I know, yours is the exception. Well, there's a lot of you that are innocent, you know, and God bless you. The thing that Satan doesn't want to do, and the whole kingdom of the earth doesn't want to do, does not want to acknowledge that there is diversity in created beings that have human forms. Because you see, that would end the guilt and shame. And if the guilt and shame was gone, then the word of God could really go forth. Then some people that had been silent would be able to speak up. Things would get done. When there's guilt and shame, there's an inertia. There's a stopping point. You know, you don't do anything. You're just fraught with guilt and shame for what you did or didn't do, or the failures of your life, or regret and remorse. If you've been forgiven, my friend, if you've been washed clean by the blood of Jesus, there shouldn't be any remorse then. There should be a complete, but there isn't. There's remorse. Am I right? So this is Jesus through me talking to you to make you realize that the remorse is vanity, and the remorse is based on a false assumption. That is, the assumption that we are all the same. And that, so therefore, based on the achievement ladder, you would be an unachiever, a failure. Not true. You're a great success. And I'm the only one around right now that's going to actually tell you that, because people are so afraid. You know, it's irrational fear, but they're afraid to look at the truth because they feel they won't measure up, or they'll be punished or something like that. So they just, you know, so we keep on kicking the can down the road every generation. And the people stay in bondage, and all the believers in Christ stay in bondage. Now, what is wrong with that picture? You know, I don't know anyone that really objects to my message here. It's just publicly they don't want to stand with it. But privately, I don't know anyone who disagrees. No one. No one. With some of the basic points that are made here. I mean, not every point, but nobody really disagrees. It's just that nobody wants to really get out on the dance floor first. Nobody really wants to say, hey, the era of guilt and shame is over, because the church couldn't control people without guilt and shame. Now could they? And the biggest shameful thing is the elephant crapping up the room that just stays there generation after generation, reminding everybody that maybe they're not with Jesus, but, you know, we'll just tell each other we are, so it'll all be cool. We'll sing Kumbaya and Amazing Grace, and everything will be fine. And the guy will talk about the rapture and preach from the word, and you know, we'll all get it, and we'll all hug each other and have a coffee and a donut, and, you know, go out to Denny's and hold hands and go to weddings and funerals, and everything's going to be all right. I have friends who are very, successful. And they're very deeply concerned. I think what's brought them to the Lord, to faith, is how troubled they are looking at the world and how they realize that all the associations and all the affiliations, all the universities, all the clubs, all the schools, all the associations have led to complete destruction. There is nothing that we've done collectively as humans that can save this situation or would lead to saving it. It keeps going down. You keep wondering why the politicians keep kicking the can down the road. They can't solve anything. And they never will be able to solve anything because as a collective body, they are. It's finally shown that they are weighed in the balances and found wanting, that they are incapable of solving our problems. Because our problems are, you know, at the heart of our existence, not laws they pass, you know. And that, you know, it's like, to be a big hero for saying you support gay marriage, which is an oxymoron. I mean, that term right there is not even a term in language that makes any sense. But the idea that they'd be conferring awards on each other for saying things like that, it's so embarrassing that, and it's so stupid, and it's so ugly. It's just unbelievable, you know. And I watch in horror as they and their affiliations, associations, and in their collectives run toward delusion and lies. Run toward feel-good stories that gets them through another day. Run toward buttering each other up because they think they might get some money. Run toward bowing down to the next guy up. As an end and means to an end. Hey, I'm not against bowing down, you know. In other words, you have a boss. Yeah, the boss orders you to do something even stupid. You know, yes, sir, go do it. I'm absolutely not against that at all. It's where your heart is. Is your heart with the Lord while you're doing that? Then you're fine. But if that boss becomes your object of worship, or you become, you know, a slave to a human, because you see, even slaves today, if they're in Christ, they're free. Prisoners in prison are free in Christ. If you're owned by someone, and you are a believer in Jesus, you're set free in Christ. So you may go through the motions because God put you there. He didn't say the end of slavery. We call it bosses and workers now, but it's still the same thing. He didn't say the end of slavery. He didn't say, you know, we have to cooperate. So people say, well, that's what we mean by conformity, you know, that agreeing to play by those rules. I'm like, well, okay, there's that. But then there's another thing to conformity, meaning a worship of Satan. So, I mean, you're trying to draw a distinction there that can't be drawn. If it didn't involve Satan, I'd say, I guess it's no problem. But, you know, if I have a job to do and I have someone over me, you know, or whatever, it doesn't bother me because I'm free. They can temporarily think they're over me, but they don't own me. God owns me. They can think they do, and I can lead them to think that by being cooperative. But what difference does it make? If my pride was involved, I'd rebel, but I have no need to rebel because I don't care. I don't care. Okay, they're serving the almighty dollar, so we conform so we can serve the almighty dollar, and then we become like the Jackson Brown song. Remember the song of the Pretender? That song is all about someone that just gave up, gave in, became part of the world system, and then struggled for money. You know, and they did it for money. It's just a very simple song. And there was a line in it that said, you know, these people grew up so young and strong only to surrender. And he's saying that, you know, we all are the pretender. Say a prayer for the pretender. And I say, yes, I have a prayer for you, Mr. Jackson Brown. I pray that you, you know, get real one day. And give up all this? You know, whatever, you know. It's intoxicating. I can understand that. I'm against, you know, rebelling, being lawless, rebelling against law, unless it's something like you can't read the Bible. But I mean, that's, you know, hurting other people. You know, condemning other people because they believe in Buddha or something, or gay rights or whatever. I'm against condemning any of these people for any of that stuff. But there's a, it needs to be discussed in light of the destruction of human souls, and so something must be said. At the same time, Trish, you're going to have to stop that because that's getting on my tape. Something must be said, and to prevent humanity from going off the cliff, at least to be a placeholder, that there was something spoken. And I'm just about, you know, I don't want to water down the message earlier by going on talking. It's just that I'm trying to, you know, explain to you that most of you had no choice, is what I mean. You were made the way you were made. And when we find each other, we go, oh, he's another one of me. You know, there's a similarity. So we have a connection. But, okay, and then over here, there's the whole social network thing, and there's no connection, and yet there is over here, and well, could we multiply that to be many? No, there's only two. Well, there's two ways, two connections. One, the big wide path, right? As Robert Plant said in his Led Zeppelin song, the open road, and the other is the narrow path. And there's also a predestiny issue involved. And it's a mystery that cannot be explained through words. But you know it when you see it. In other words, I'm here to tell you that if you take the guilt and shame off of you, in other words, berating yourself for what you did or didn't do, feeling like you're a loser, you know, all those feelings, feeling guilt and shame so you're going to go ahead and drink or eat or trash yourself or do something destructive, to reinforce the devil's plan for you, which is basically to destroy you, rather than seeing yourself as being a complete success, that the fact that you're standing there is a great achievement, and you've overcome all of their, everything they could throw at you, but you didn't. It was him who did, so you really owe your life to him, and realizing that it's all good with God, and that there's not a mistake here. And if believers that you run into sound like you, I'm in Christ, and then they expect you to corrupt yourself in some way, that's not a believer. They've deluded themselves into thinking they're believers, but that's not a believer. That's a collectivist. Those are people that, you know, they want to put a group together because they feel there's safety in numbers, and that's utterly ridiculous. You shouldn't be concerned about your death anyway, and you shouldn't be concerned about things you've done or haven't done in the past. The Lord brings up men and women that he wants. The world brings them up another way, what they want. What they call a man on this planet, not a man, ultimately. What they call a woman on this planet is not a woman until they're born again. You have to be born, you have to be changed in the spirit to be a man or a woman. You can't be a fully emancipated man unless you have Christ. There's no way, you can be a head of a big corporation and you can make $10 million a year or $1 billion a year or whatever, you know, hundreds of millions or whatever it is. You can have boats and planes at your beck and call. You can make decisions that affect the world every day. But you would be a mere ignorant little child. I mean, the way God would see you would be as like an urchin, like a street urchin's in Dickens' time, right? That's how God would see you. He wouldn't see you as what you think you are, a big corporate exec. You wouldn't see that. Yeah. Not to say that the guy on the street then is, you know, like I've always said, there can be somebody eating caviar and drinking champagne and prime rib, living up in a tower on Park Avenue, be completely walking with Yahweh through Christ. And there can be a person begging for crumbs on the road, and they could be going straight to hell through their, you know, through their affiliation, their rebellion, the way they were made, whatever, any number of factors. So appearances do not speak the truth. The outward appearance of a person does not say anything about that person. You know, seriously, it doesn't. You know, you see somebody wealthy, oh, that they're going to hell. Someone poor, oh, they're saved. That's false. That's completely false. You see somebody, you know, fat, you go, oh, look at that. They must be very undisciplined and I can't even imagine. That's false. It's not a discipline problem at all. Most people who have fat, there's a number of reasons, including the one of Yahweh's protection for people who are vain. If you have a certain amount of vanity, and then you end up fat and, say, undesirable sexually, let's say, you know, it would be to protect you from being desirable sexually because you couldn't handle it. And any number of further examples of that. Because you will recluse yourself and you don't want to be mocked or judged, so you won't go to certain places. Great! Then for those few of you who heard this podcast today, you'll say, thank you, Lord, for everything. My appearance, my situation, my place, everything that I complained about. If I didn't have those things, I would have died that spiritual death. Thank you. I wouldn't have made it. Great achievement. The world will see you and go, loser, and I'm here to tell you, you've made a great achievement. You don't have to say anything. A lot of times he'll put someone there and just have them sit over in the corner. People just walk by. They don't pay any attention to them. But that one sitting in the corner is speaking volumes in the spirit to all those around. And big work is getting done. So never think that if you're silent or not doing something on the internet or not doing something in the, you know, barking outside the church like a rabid dog with your sign or whatever it is, that's also a false assumption. The guy with the plaque doesn't necessarily mean he's saved. Means he's got a plaque. The guy speaking to the church doesn't mean he's godly either. The guy who says he's a man of God doesn't mean he's godly either. The guy that sits in judgment of me, well, that's a big red flag right there. You know, I'm just correcting you, brother, because you need to be corrected. And then the red flag goes up. It's like, okay, I assess myself. What did I do? Oh, I didn't do anything wrong. So you're correcting me. You're judging me. You're judging me. Now, I don't mind if you, you know, kick me out of your fellowships or you don't want me around at your socials or whatever. You don't want me to influence your children because you want them to be successful in physical monetary terms, so they're going to toe the line. You're teaching them that. I'm not even judging you for doing that. You're falling into the same pattern your parents did. You're falling in the same fallen humanity pattern that they've done from the beginning. The same. Look how Barack Obama, for example, fell into the same pattern as all the presidents before him. You know, left his, you know, he's got the drones going and all this stuff that's really the liberal base would hate. And he's fallen right into all those patterns, trying to say everything to everybody, trying to keep it going. It's pathetic. He couldn't fight against it. That's just the way he was made. That's who he is. He's not a man of substance. He'll say anything to anyone to get elected. It's all about money and power, and you know. And he's never really woken up to the idea that there's something more to than this physical plane. He's never considered it. He's a very carnal individual. Same with Bill Clinton. And I suppose, to a lesser degree, Bush, to a lesser degree than those two. But they all fall into similar patterns because you can't actually get to the truth through man's ways. And if you want to be president, you know, there's a big force that's saying there's tradition and you need to follow that. And that's just the way of corruption. That's the big white path. And that goes off the cliff. And so if I'm not surprised if I see, you know, Putin firing off intercontinental ballistic missiles and, this eventually goes to a hot war, and then Obama and the whole Congress sell us out to the Russians, like we'll sit here and be nuked, but our own guys sold us out. Do you think that would surprise me? Does that shock you that that could happen? Or even better, that the U.S. military will be used to kill its own citizens. Would that shock me? Absolutely. That's perfect. That's exactly who they are. That's exactly what's wrong with the planet. That is what this planet's about. Or Wall Street goes off the cliff with more derivatives after not learning their lesson the first time. Would that surprise me? Absolutely not. It doesn't surprise me at all because I know who they are. I know they need help.
In this country, they do not confront the spiritual reality of birth, which is the reason for their existence in the first place. They think they were just born to be kings, queens, powerful, rule over other people. It's all, they haven't a clue what's going on. Not a clue what existence is. Not a clue what breathing air is. What a clue what consciousness really is. What spirit is. Because if they did, they wouldn't be able to rule. They would have to be vetted by the forces that rule over this planet, which is carnal, not spiritual. You vet yourself in the carnal. You beat the other guy. You pull yourself up by your bootstraps. You beat the next guy. You take that guy out. You take this, and finally you get your shot. You go for the brass ring. And that's the brutal reality of what it is. So I have no interest in that. I have no interest in, if I were going to be a warrior, let's say, and go and fight in the martial arts to win the prize, it would have to be for the Lord, for some other thing. I couldn't do it just to beat the other guy because that wouldn't give me enough motivation. Or just to get a prize, that wouldn't do it for me either. I don't care. It would have to be, I want to be the best because Yahweh made me that way and Yahweh told me to do it, so I'm going to go ahead and with his power do it. There have been many a fighter, many a boxer, many an athlete who had just that attitude, and you know who they are, and succeeded wildly beyond everyone's expectations, proving once again that Yahweh is God, and he's the source. And, you know, the way of the world is pathetic, period. End of story. And that the way of the world and the rules of the world that say if you don't conform to us, you won't be able to be successful or have anything or do anything, all bogus. All complete hogwash. But humanity, ignorant as they are, the unwashed, which is, you know, in Europe and America would be more unwashed than anybody, they have never learned these lessons. They think you go to church on Sunday to figure this out, and then they're back to business as usual on Monday. That is complete, utter insanity. And you would listen to, would you invite a guy like Barack Obama into your home and then just listen to whatever he says because he's the president, and like, oh yeah, and take it to heart? Are you kidding me? Unless he says something truthful or that has a spirit of truth, not just feigning truth, you wouldn't listen if you're a real person. You, my friends, you people that listen to this podcast, you're real people, and the world must reject you for that. You were born different, but for a purpose. Some of you are born just to stand there. That's your job. Just to stand there is the opposite, you know, which freaks them out. All right? And to a lesser and more hopeful degree, that goes for the rest of the people that call themselves believers. The goal is, eventually one day, they're going to get off the mother's milk. They're going to you know, actually be able to separate. You know, actually be able to walk on their own, you know, to not care what, you know, to not have their minds controlled by the world. In other words, to rate themselves as losers or winners or, gosh, I should have done that better, or regret and remorse. Or worry. I spent a lot of time in guilt and shame. I didn't know why. And I would torture myself for not doing this better, not doing that better, not being one of them, not, you know, fitting in, not, you know, all these things. Now, it's just horrible. I just tortured myself endlessly for, you know, which was like, you know, an orangutan torturing himself for not being a gorilla. It's completely, utterly useless. I let it go. And then a great sense of peace came over me. You know, what really matters is how I answer to my father, and the rest of it just doesn't matter. You know, I know their opinions of those who are not towing the line. I mean, their line, whatever. There's lines everywhere, but I mean, it's basically the same line, right? There's all kinds of hierarchies and things and hoops to jump through, but they're all over the world in different groups, but it's all the same kind of thing. I mean, the whole idea of degree, getting a degree, was a Luciferian concept.
That you had to go through the hierarchy, the sort of militaristic hierarchy, is reptilian in its nature and part of the fall of humanity. Now, I graduated, yay! And then the emptiness, because it's you jump through the devil's hoop. I'm not saying don't graduate. I'm just saying it's not of God. When man confers a degree on you, it's got nothing to do with God. It has nothing to do with your existence. It just means that man will now trust you to employ you to do something. A lot of people in prison that think they shouldn't be there, that they were singled out because they were different. And they were made to do bad things, but they didn't really do it. I mean, there is that going on. For those who are conscious in prison, there's a lot of people unconscious in prison, just like in humanity. And they become believers in all this, but I'm here to tell you, if you're listening from prison, there's a false assumption that one day you'll be as good as them on the outside. One day you'll be, you know, you're buying into their view of you, that you have to come up and pull yourself up and pull yourself together. My friend, I'm here to tell you I'm the same today as I was at 3. Same spirit, same thoughts, same wiring, same everything. And so are you. What manifested as crime that you did do, and don't say you didn't do it when you did, because you did. And you got caught, and you got put in prison. And then you tried to play a victim and say, well, humanity made me do that, and I'm really a lamb and all that. No, I'm sorry. But whatever made you do those things usually has to do with guilt, shame, abuse, whatever. Just like when people who feel they failed at society, they failed at life, they failed through man's hoops, they failed, and then go drink, and they beat themselves up, and they put needles in their arms, and some of them actually steal TV sets and whatnot, and cars, and it just goes from there. The people that give up and surrender right away tend not to be in prison. They tend to be on a life raft, hanging on with everybody else, hoping that the truth of the situation will eventually go away, which it never will, which is that it's a pretender. It's not real, in other words. It's not real. They just, they were given a deal, and they said, give up. They said, okay, I surrender. I'm with you guys. And then, in order to avoid the fate that they see other people going through, that's horrible. How can we blame them? I need money. I need protection. I need people to have my back. And so I'm taking the deal. I mean, you're not going to send me to hell for that, are you? God, are you going to send me to hell for giving up? You want me to fight all humanity? No, false paradigm. Who says you're fighting all humanity if you don't give in to that? You'd have to actually accept their premise to then give up to their premise. Here's the best one. The best example of this was Bill Clinton. Okay. When he was talking about who is that guy, who is that old senator that Byrd, and he was like a member of the KKK early on, and Bill Clinton gave a eulogy, and he gave this excellent example. this sums it all up. It's almost as good as Jackson Browne's "The Pretender," which is a great song and just lays it out exactly right. But this is even better. He goes. They asked Clinton about, well, why was he in the KKK, and he goes, well, he had to do that to get elected. That's exactly right. He had to do that or he wouldn't be elected. He didn't want to be a loser. And so goes the world, right? That is it. That's it. And that was the most concise example of what we're talking about given by anybody. Leave it to Clinton to come up with something like that. That was the perfect. And he had no qualms about it, no shame about it. It was just matter of fact. Well, of course he had to do that to get elected. Next question. I mean, it's a no-brainer. Excuse me. Come on. Right? That was his attitude. It was beautiful. I mean, you have to actually see the video of that to really understand the more matter of fact that Clinton was, the more it pounds the point in. And that very thing, if everybody does it, eventually brings the world to its knees to death and destruction. Not to life everlasting. There are some people that have written songs about the real triumph will be when we're all connected as one. And they really want to kill everybody that won't conform to that idea. And they think, you're blocking our utopia. Now, I didn't. These are kind of like left-wing kind of people. But yeah, there is that. Or if anyone who's against gay marriage should be killed. And we get, to a certain lesser degree, it goes on down from there. But there's the but all those are manifestations of the central underlying issue, which is that the corruption's within us, forcing us to recreate that corruption in the collective with other people outside of ourselves, in the name of doing good, in the name of prosperity, in the name of God, in the name of all good things, in the name of our children, in the name of success, in the name of, well, we had to do this or we wouldn't be able to build the space shuttle. Does that feel any easier? Look, the main point is you can't beat yourself up if you weren't made a gorilla, if you're an orangutan. You can't do it. It's not the ways of the world and the measuring of success of the world doesn't apply. He had to do that to become elected. But you, that's not you. That you know, that was him, but that's not you. You're not the same as Byrd, Senator Byrd. You're not like him. You weren't made like him. To him, that was, you know, there wasn't even a choice. It was just, there wasn't anything to give up. Jackson Brown's song is a little more like indicating that the kids are young and strong, railing against the world, and they're fighting against the world, but then they just end up surrendering anyway. You know, probably he's talking about the 60s and the rebelliousness of the 60s against the system, only to assimilate everyone later on. And remember how the hippies became yuppies, right? And so he's talking about really surrendering to Satan, but justifying it by saying, you know, otherwise I wouldn't have any money. I wouldn't be a famous singer. Or whatever. Another false assumption. You, on the other hand, were not given the same opportunity, nor are you the same person as, say, Mr. Brown. But you've, let's say you're a songwriter, you've beaten yourself up for not having some of that success. You're not, that's the false paradigm. Had you just sold your soul, you could have been a contender. No? They would have killed you if you were of Yahweh. They would have killed you because that's what they do. Just take my word for it. They kill as many of, quote, their own as anybody else. In fact, more. Because of the same issue we're talking about. What's in you? Who are you? Are you like us? No, but he's vetted. Well, we can't trust him completely because he's not exactly the same. So, you know, eventually there's an accident. It's amazing. I'm side case in point back to pop culture again. Rock stars that die at 27 years old, you know, obviously sacrifices. You can't prove it because it's like an accidental overdose, it's this or that. But there was a thing like that. There was like a thing going on. Kurt Cobain, you know, people that would have eventually probably been a problem because they weren't quite the same. I'm not saying that anything about Cobain. I don't know. I just know that I'm at peace with it. I'm at peace with
it all. It's like if I lose 20 pounds, I'm going to be happy. No, I've let that go. The Lord will deal with me on that, whichever way. If If I had done this or that in life, I would have been here or there. No, that was not going to happen. From three, it was clear what it was going to be. My life went exactly as I thought from 3 years old on, and there were no surprises in any of it. If I had just not been so prideful and just kind of gone along to get along, I'd be a lot further ahead. No. If you're like me, you'd be dead. I would have killed you. Well, then there's no choice. That's right. That's right. You had a reason for your birth. And it wasn't to be a big pastor or some big worker of God. It was to stand there. It was to be unsuccessful in their terms and still yet stand there. You getting it? You ready to let the guilt and shame go? The resentment? You ready to let the curse you put on yourself go for not being the right sort or not being this or not being that or whatever it is you weren't? Don't you understand that you're not anything like that? You're a different species altogether. You know, the ugly duckling was really a swan. I mean, don't you get that? Don't you understand? Your outcome is exactly what was preordained before you even got here. If you have redress issues, take them to Father right now. I say, Father, thank you for what I consider to be afflictions. Now I realize were a benefit. Thank you, because the whole thing has kept me running the race. When they mocked and laughed and done whatever and teased and do what they do, was there any sting to that? Is there any scar on that? No, not at all. The joke's really on them, because I'm, you know, these petty-minded people get together and mock Elijah, right? Now, who ended up going up in the world? Who went right to God? Elijah. What happened to them? They died miserable deaths. Then I say this to anybody. If you come to the Lord in any way, shape, or form, then you're not like the world. You know? Paul survived to be able to then be converted. But that proves that he wasn't really exactly like the world from the get-go. There was something different about him, and he managed to survive. Or God managed him to survive because God knew what he was going to do. So when they persecute you and when they come against you, it's not about you. It's about who you are in God, who you are in the kingdom. And that if you are someone in that, if you have a pedigree at all, then that's a threat to the prevailing society, which is based on its own destruction and is already today a complete, total, utter failure. And everyone who participates in it is a failure. Whether they give themselves Nobel Prizes or whatever prizes they give themselves, they do that because they're in denial. They give more and more prizes to keep the thing going, which shouldn't be going in the first place. You're right. They're wrong. End of story. Okay? That's it. Now, if you could just live like that, you'd be free. Jesus Christ today has set you free. Please don't say you're in Christ and yet be in self-loathing bondage and self-hatred and critical and shame and guilt and resentment and remorse, because a person like that is not really, doesn't really have Christ or the Holy Spirit, obviously. You're a new creature. What does the Bible say? We are a new creation. We are crucified with Christ, that is, the world will torture you, but then we are resurrected, born again. Yet it's not us, but Jesus lives in us, and we just are vehicles. We're vessels of God. And the world is going to do everything it can to prevent there being vessels of God making an influence, because they are all about the status quo and keeping the thing going. Putin
is in the same club as Obama and the same club as Akhundini. They're all, you know, back in their various Masonic lodges and things. They're all connected behind the scenes. So when Putin fires a missile, it's you know, basically it's all theater at this point. At some point, they may want to go ahead and, you know, take out humanity, but they realize that along the way, if that's not God's plan, then they'll be taken out. So they're very serious about what I'm talking about. They have sorcerers and psychics, all kinds of, you know, they hire the Tibetans and everybody else to try to figure all this stuff out. What I've told you in basically 2 hours, they take years and volumes of material and they still don't get it done. So take this to heart and please remove your shackles. They're not locked. And just walk out of here. Okay, we love you. Praying for you, and we'll see you. Zeph Daniel, roving reporter. For all you lovely misfits who thought you were so awful, it turns out now you're the one thing standing between the existence of humanity and a complete destruction, and you're it, just standing there. You're almost like the finger in the dike that's holding back the destruction. You ever think about it that way? No, you cannot trust world leaders to do anything. You just pray that the Lord's plan, you know, is to protect his lambs, and that he, you know, with Obama, he can't do what he wants. Every day he says a different thing. He's obviously, you know, he's more and more ineffective and has no credibility to anybody. I mean, but they keep promoting it because they want global warming and whatever else, taxes and money. But the thing is it's all about money with them anyway. But you can see the Lord's God. I had predicted that he'll have one thing after another, one blow after another, till he's just brought all the way down. Because, and the reason that the Lord's doing this is because of his arrogance and his pride. And that's really why he's crumbling. You know, also we reap what we sow. If you go out droning people and killing their families and stuff, eventually it's going to come right back on him. And there's no place he can run, no place he can hide. He's done. He's finished. And, you know, they keep trying to prop up the corpse, but he's done in terms of his political life, and he's done in terms of being any kind of professor. He's done in terms of, I can't imagine anyone reading a book that he would write today because he's so full of crap. I can't imagine any, you know, they got by with all this because he's black, figuring, okay, we can play the race card to shut everybody up. But of course, that's ridiculous. But he's emblematic of he's symptomatic of the kind of humanity we have in Congress and the kind of humanity that are in powerful positions. The bank fails. The businesses fail. The president fails. The Congress fails. The EU fails. Right? Russia fails. All fails. China fails. Everybody fails. Everything is ugly. Everything is based on collective conformity ends up being complete total destruction for those who participate in it. So, those of you who are just standing there, thank you for your service. I know they throw rocks at you, but thank you. Thank you. But you don't take it personally, right? No guilt and shame, right? Thank you. And I'll see you next time.